Former First Lady Nancy Reagan will be laid to rest today. In about an hour, her funeral service will begin in Simi Valley, California, at the Reagan Presidential Library. Friends and family will be on hand to celebrate her remarkable life in and out of the White House.
Mrs. Reagan died on Sunday at the age of 94 from congestive heart failure. Tributes have been pouring in ever since, with flags lowered at half-staff across the country for a woman who helped redefine the role of the First Lady. And today, she will be buried next to her beloved husband, former President Ronald Reagan.
We will bring you full coverage of the entire service this afternoon. Bill Plante is our senior White House correspondent. He's going to be joining us all throughout this. Susan Zirinsky is a senior executive producer of 48 Hours. She's here with us in the studio. Both have covered the Reagan White House.
But first, let's bring in Ben Tracy, who is at the site of today's funeral. Ben, who will be attending today's service?
Well, Elaine, the service begins in just about an hour, and we've seen many people already arrive. The Hollywood contingent is out in full force. We've seen John Stamos, Tom Selleck, Wayne Newton, Bo Derek, Johnny Mathis. Right behind me here, people are basically arriving in town cars and buses. A lot of the political VIPs, former President George W. Bush, First Lady Michelle Obama, Hillary Clinton, those people have not yet arrived. We expect them to arrive much closer to the start of the service.
Ben, what kind of security arrangements are we seeing there at the funeral?
Lots of security. You know, when you have a former president, a current first lady, and a lot of other former first ladies, you're going to have the Secret Service. So, yeah, there definitely is a presence here. And that's part of why you're seeing people sitting down and getting into this this space an hour before this even begins. That's because the Secret Service has to keep this orderly, make sure everybody is in there before the folks who actually have protection arrive.
And Ben, even before today, there was an opportunity not just for those close to the Reagan family, but also for members of the public as well to express their well wishes, their condolences, their support for the family. Tell us about some of those scenes.
It really has been extraordinary. I mean, the past few days, there have been more than 5,500 people who have come up here. And keep in mind, we're out in Simi Valley, which is well outside of Los Angeles, on top of a hilltop. This is not an easy place to get to. So 5,500 people have come here to pay their respects to Mrs. Reagan. They boarded buses, they came up the hill, they waited in line. And that was really important to her. She knew that her funeral had to be private, just given the kind of people that were going to be involved in it. But she wanted that opportunity for the public to be able to come say their goodbyes.
Ben, you noted some of the people that are arriving already at the funeral. We know that First Lady Michelle Obama is also expected to attend. Has she arrived yet?
We have not seen the First Lady yet. We expect her to arrive much closer to the start of the program. And it's interesting, you know, earlier in the week, the Reagan Library put out a list of people who would be speaking at the event, and Mrs. Obama's name was on it. And then when we got an updated list yesterday, it was not. And we asked, you know, what happened? And they said that they had asked her if she wanted to speak, and she respectfully declined, saying that she would rather attend as a guest. But some of the speakers will include Nancy Reagan's daughter, Patty Davis, her son, Ron Reagan Jr., and the former Prime Minister of Canada is also going to read a love letter that Ronald Reagan once wrote to his First Lady.
Ben, that is a great segue to bring in some of our other guests here. We're going to be talking throughout this funeral, but let's bring in Bill Plante. Bill, I want to talk to you about that love story, that love affair that began when they first met on that great war movie, Hellcats of the Navy. I actually saw it, believe it or not, and how it blossomed into one of the most enduring love stories in American history.
Well, the Hellcats of the Navy was generally agreed to be their worst movie ever. But nonetheless, it was the only one that they were in together. And of course, the way that Nancy Reagan met Ronald Reagan was that she was an actress in Hollywood, a starlet, I guess you'd say. And her name appeared on a list that was published in a newspaper of people in support of some of the blacklisted writers. And those were assumed to be communists. And there was a big Red Scare in the 40s. So she went to friends in Hollywood and said, hey, I need to talk to the president of the Screen Actors Guild, and that was Ronald Reagan, to make sure that my name is cleared. So they went and had dinner together, and things developed from there. And 3 years later, they were married. It was his second marriage and her first. But their love affair, Vlad, was something that was so evident to all of us who watched them through the years. They were constantly together. They would embrace in public. You made a reference to the love letter that former Canadian Prime Minister Mulroney is going to read. There was one famous letter that Ronald Reagan wrote to Nancy Reagan on their 31st anniversary, and it became public, and he wrote to his wife, "I more than love you," he said. "I'm not whole without you. You are life itself to me. When you are gone, I'm waiting for you to return so I can start living again." That really was a deep bond.
Wow, it's just incredibly moving. Susan, so let me ask you, because part of that love story I think is so fascinating, is Nancy Reagan's ferocious, protective nature when it came to her husband. I love Leslie Stahl, a 60 Minutes correspondent who also covered the Reagan White House. She said that Nancy Reagan was the consigliere.
Oh, my God, yes. I mean, I think that many first ladies have a kind of controversial relationship with the press, but her just distinctive protective shell really was then looked at by the press as like, you're the enemy and we are, I need to protect him. There was this really kind of fractured relationship, and there was even controversy. There was one trip where Reagan was at the ranch and he was talking about nuclear arms, and the press was kind of hounding him, and she was standing next to him, and she mouthed what she said to herself, "We're doing all we can." And then Reagan said it out loud, but she was really quiet, and it wasn't until we looked at the tape that we actually saw it. So here's this, she is protecting him, she's there with to finish the sentences. You know, they used to also have these parties for the press, but a lot of times she didn't show up. It was just President Reagan. So you can understand the relationship. I do think, though, that the press corps really felt that they had this very unique, unique relationship. Don Regan, former chief of staff, said there was no move ever made, no move ever made without her consent, and he got fired.
Right. There are a lot of people who have talked about that, how she was maybe not instrumental, but it was certainly a factor in the decision to let the former chief of staff go. Bill, there's one thing, though, that she could not protect him from. In 1981, just a few weeks into his second term, a would-be assassin fired on President Reagan. Talk about what it was like to cover not only that assassination attempt, but also what Nancy struggled with.
Well, this hit her harder than anything in her life. The notion that she could lose this man whom she loved so much was shattering to her. And when that happened, she spent days at the hospital while he was in recovery. We didn't really know, by the way, how serious that wound was. We found out in the ensuing months, but he almost died. And the fact, she knew that, and that fact just haunted her. So she was more protective than ever after the assassination attempt. And that, by the way, is when she turned to an astrologer. She was reaching out, as she said later, just reaching out to anybody I could find. And she began getting from the astrologer what were supposed to be good dates for the president to do things like travel. And that persisted through the rest of his term. And when she was instrumental in getting Don Regan fired, and by the way, she was instrumental, he retaliated by writing about it in his book, blowing the fact that she had had this astrologer. And I think one example that he gave was that Air Force One had to sit on the tarmac and wait for takeoff until the auspicious moment.
Sue, let me ask you, because after that assassination attempt, you got to see the change in Nancy Reagan that Bill's talking about. And I know at one point you thought he would not run for re-election because she was so fiercely against the idea.
You know, the assassination attempt did really change the dynamic of her. It made the protective bubble even more intense. And just one thing on the astrologer, she did feel helpless. And I think even those of us in the press corps with the responsibility of kind of finding everything out, you know, we reported it as incredulous that the president of the United States' wife, and he was a fan also, don't get me wrong, he was a fan of astrology. So, but you felt that here she was, no one could protect him. Here's the president of the United States walking out of the Washington Hilton Hotel, and he's gunned down, and so was N.A. Jim Brady. So this was like, if they can't be protected, that's why I think she really was so, felt so vulnerable. Her ability to come at us. And what your question was really about
how she changed it. Now, you thought that she would not allow him essentially to run again after that assassination.
This
attempt.
Is true, and Bill knows this. There was a group of people, and James Baker, who's one of the speakers today, who's a terrific guy, and he was a very dominant figure in the Reagan White House. So several of us went out in Santa Barbara, and what was really amusing is that Jim Baker was saying, I don't know, he may run, he may run. I was so convinced, I think so was Leslie Stahl, I'm not sure if Bill, where Bill stood, that he wouldn't run again because she only wanted one term. She couldn't bear putting him out there again. And so we had a little money wager, quite frankly, and I think it was like $75, and the next day or a couple of days later, Jim Baker was on Face the Nation, and he leaves me a note on a yellow legal pad with his handwriting, and it says, I'll let you out of your bet for X number of cents to the dollar if you call me within 24 hours. I took the challenge, and I said, not only do I not take this bet, I'm increasing it to 100. So, of course, he runs. Baker was right. I was wrong. And I got a framed $100 bill with a rubber hammer, and I had it brought up to Air Force One on our next trip, and it said, break if elected. And James Baker took it with him to the Treasury in case the deficit needed my 100 bucks.
That's a great story. That is a great story. Before we even move on, I just realized that I said second term of President Reagan when he was the attempt for assassination. Yes. Was actually his first term. But Bill, about Nancy Reagan, and the platform that as a child of the 80s growing up, I remember very vividly the Just Say No to Drugs campaign. And, you know, there have been very powerful first ladies, or at least prominent first ladies, Lady Bird Johnson and Rosalind Carter, Betty Ford. But this was the first time as a child seeing the first lady front and center. And she appeared on Different Strokes. If there's anybody who's watching CBSN and remembers that TV show,
when you're
11 or 12 right. And you see the first lady of the United States on like your favorite comedy show, it has a huge impact. What was the impetus for her getting involved with that?
Well, she, like most first ladies, wanted to identify with a cause. And at the time, the crack epidemic was rampant in American large cities. So she took up the opposition to drugs, the Just Say No campaign, and she quite really believed in it. But it was also something that she needed to do, she felt, as a first lady, to make a contribution. So she went all out, and they took advantage of their Hollywood connections. She appeared on many popular television shows. There were national advertising campaigns. And she was sometimes ridiculed for it as having very little effect coming from this fancy first lady. But certainly the message couldn't have hurt.
Look, it's become part of the expression, Just Say No.
That's right.
And I want to pick up on something that Bill said. Her involvement with celebrity and bold-faced names, she understood the value of it. I think, you know, when Ben Tracy was mentioning all the celebrities that were coming, she pulled people into causes. She really did. Even, you know, some of the singers and the artists in the entertainment world, they all kind of said, let's be a part of this. Look, I mean, she got Ronald Reagan involved in AIDS because of their relationship with Rock Hudson. So these are things, and even her relationship with other people on Alzheimer's. She knew how to navigate the issues and really attempt to bring in people who could make a difference.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. Our coverage of Nancy Reagan's funeral will continue on the other side of that break. We'll be hearing from retired General Colin Powell, President Reagan's former national security advisor.
Stay with us. You're watching CBSN. Right now, this is the scene in Simi Valley. Any moment now, we are expecting the prelude to the funeral service here. The Santa Susana High School Advanced Women's Choir and the 1st Marine Division Band from the Marine Corps Camp Pendleton base is scheduled to begin the prelude part of that service. We were going to continue to keep our eye, of course, on this picture here for our continuing coverage. We have been seeing a number of notables coming to attend, and there we hear the beginning strains of that prelude. Let's go ahead and listen in.
right. You've just been listening there to the prelude in this service, this farewell tribute to Nancy Reagan, which will conclude with her funeral a little bit later today. That was the 1st Marine Division Band, along with the Santa Susana High School Advanced Women's Choir. We're going to continue to monitor what is happening there at the funeral and bring you live images as they come in. There you see some celebrities, news anchors making their way. We saw Larry King, there's Joe Scarborough. One of the things that Nancy Reagan is most remembered for is her influence in the White House. She was her husband's closest advisor and was a key figure in shaping policy.
Colin Powell was President Reagan's former national security advisor. He shared his memories of Nancy and Ronald after her passing.
I came in at the last two years of the Reagan administration, and the presidency was in trouble. He was in trouble because of Iran-Contra. And she was determined to help those of us who came in, myself, Frank Carlucci, National Security Advisor, Howard Baker, and Ken Duberstein in the Chief of Staff's office. And she was a friend and ally, and she could be an adversary if she didn't like what was going on.
Can you give us an example of that?
She was a dominant presence in the White House. A good example of that is the Don Regan case is a classic example. When she knew that Don Regan had to be moved on as chief of staff and bring in Howard Baker, she merely leaked it to the press, and the press had it on CNN. I was the deputy national security advisor, and my boss, Frank Carlucci, said, "Have you seen television?" I said, "Yes." He said, "I wonder if Don knows." And it was Frank Carlucci who went down to Don's office and said, "Don, did you resign? It's on television." And Don looked up bewildered, and he immediately wrote his resignation letter, took it to the president's office, and left the White House.
Wow.
That's hardball, fellas. That is hardball.
And General Paul, you tell a great story that if she was gone for too long, those of you in the White House would say, "We need to get her back here." How much did he depend on her? Tell us about that.
It was total, and you said it earlier in the setup piece. Without him, there was no. Without her, there was no complete him. And whenever she went to New York to shop or visit friends and other interests, we knew after about 24 to 48 hours, he started to become fretful. He started to become distracted. And on the third day, we would have a little meeting. Somebody call up there and tell her she's got to come home. It was that direct. You could see it. It was visible. And he was incomplete without her presence. And I saw it throughout that two-year period I was privileged to serve with him. She was tough, but her toughness always related to taking care of her man, her Ronnie. And it touched us all deeply. And after they left the White House and I left the White House, we stayed in touch. And she became much more mellow in the after period. And Alma and I spent some pleasant time with them out at the library. I'll never forget visiting them at their home in Bel Air with a young soldier who had driven me there and went up to the door, knocked on the door. President Reagan opened the door. Nancy was right behind him. And the young soldier saluted President Reagan, and Reagan saluted him back. And then the soldier went back to the car. Reagan closed the door, and he said to me, "Is it okay if I still salute?" And I said, "Mr. President, don't ever stop." And Nancy was just standing there beaming and smiling. She was an indomitable presence. She really completed the man.
Bill Plante and Susan Zirinsky. Susan, you were nodding your head as Colin Powell there was talking about when the two were separated, that Ronald Reagan would become fretful. He started to become sort of worried, and they could see it manifest itself. That separation was very, very difficult for him, even if it was for a short time. Did you witness things like that?
Absolutely. And, you know, the word at the White House was, and Colin Powell said it, if she was gone a couple of days, he had to ask her to come back, because he really had this inability to feel comfortable without her support. Larry Speaks used to talk about it all the time. It's you, if you weren't in her circle, you weren't in the circle. And the Don Regan story is absolutely accurate and how things were. I mean, I think that people really didn't understand how influential she was on policy. You know, when Hillary Clinton was in the White House, Michelle Obama, you feel their intellectual presence. She wasn't out there promoting that. But when we really figured it out, you saw it. And so did everybody around her.
Bill, I want to ask you about the Iran-Contra scandal. This, for viewers who may not be familiar with the story, was the United States essentially selling weapons to Iran and using the proceeds of those weapons to fund the Contras in Nicaragua, who were fighting the democratically elected government at the time. That scandal sort of, I'm curious for both of you that who were covering the White House at the time, how the press played it out and how it affected Nancy, because there were a lot of people who were saying that President Reagan wasn't aware of these things that was happening. How did she take that, Nancy?
Well, first of all, President Reagan himself insisted that he was never really aware that they were selling arms to Iran and the money was going to the Contras. The Contras were a rebel force fighting against, as you said, the democratically elected government, but the democratically elected government of Nicaragua at the time was leftist, and therefore anathema to the Reagan administration. There was an additional problem, though. Congress had voted specifically a law that said you couldn't support the Contras, and yet the executive branch was funneling money to them. This turned out to be a huge problem, as we know, and Mrs. Reagan is the one who determined that in order for this to go away, the president had to apologize. He resisted mightily. And when he did apologize, he still said, I don't have the exact quote in front of me, but something like, I still don't believe I did it, but I'm sorry. Mm. And she was the one who, this is after Reagan's resignation, she was the one who made sure that he went on television and said this was a mistake. And when he did that, it helped to clear things up.
What do you remember? She was,
you know, I remember because as the production side, you know, we heard all these rumors that she was really mad. I mean, you have to understand, there were bizarre things that were coming out from Capitol Hill. Bud McFarlane, who was national security then, he went to Iran with a cake in the shape of a key. I mean, a James Bond movie might not give you that kind of a detail. I think what upset her and, you know, from the First Lady's office, and I had friends there, it was that he didn't know. And how could this be happening where he'd be held responsible, where the President of the United States would be held responsible and not know? I mean, we're selling arms, we're funding the Contras, cake in shapes of keys. Mm-hmm. It just was kind of crazy times.
Yeah. And Susan, I'm struck also by the sense that she had a real understanding of quote-unquote optics, something that, you know, nowadays there's this political-industrial complex that is versed in how the public might perceive something, you know, studied in, talk to me about
so,
that.
Absolutely. There was a key aide who Bill Plante knew very well named Mike Deaver, and Mike Deaver was about the optics, and he and Nancy were absolutely, I mean, we're talking tied at the hip. You know, when the president went to Santa Barbara and he was isolated on this ranch, the press corps was down in Santa Barbara, you know, 30 minutes away, but we actually found a mountain that overlooked the Reagan Ranch. And we had a lens that was built by NASA. It was pretty extraordinary. I mean, when that lens was put on the camera and the local photographer took a picture and appeared in the paper, Nancy Reagan actually put a curtain on her bathroom window because we're looking 3 miles. But the optics was tough. There were controversies that happened, and we would see the president get on his horse, wavy pictures, and kind of ride around. And the most controversial was when a plane was shot down. It was 007 in Asia, and the president was riding horses. The optics were terrible. And when we went on television with it, it was Nancy and Deaver who said, we have to go back to Washington today. Mm. All about the optics.
Didn't want to
see the president riding his horse, even if it was a wavy picture from 3 miles away.
Let's talk about the optics, Bill. I will ask you to compare and contrast, although we don't always want to do that, but compare and contrast the Camelot presidency. There's another first lady who's also considered to be a glamorous first lady. That was the wife of JFK, Jacqueline Kennedy. The White House, the age of Camelot, vis-a-vis the Reagan presidency, where we were coming off a pretty tough time economically, but by all extents, Nancy and Ronald Reagan were Hollywood people in addition to him being a politician. She did try to bring a bit of that glamour to the White House and ultimately did, but it was tough in the beginning.
No question about it. I mean, I think you can say that Jackie Kennedy's idea of Camelot and Nancy Reagan's idea of what the White House should be like were very similar in some respects. Not in all the details, perhaps, but in the idea that it should be a showplace for the nation, something that stands out. But as you point out, Vlad, we were in the middle of a recession from 1979 to 82, and when she raised $800,000 from outside contributors to redecorate the White House, there was a firestorm. Then she got another $200,000 to buy a set of china for the White House. That sounds like a lot of money, but there were 220 pieces in the set or something like that, or place settings, rather. So, and the president defended her, saying, well, we haven't had new china in the White House since the Truman administration. But it was those things were very important to her, the idea of presenting the White House and the presidency as an ideal for the nation.
And Bill, as we look at the attendees, we see former Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger there. I think it's Peggy Noonan that he's talking
Peggy
to.
Noonan.
Yeah,
yes.
I can see there, right? So Peggy Noonan there. We have seen him coming in. Z, what are your remembrances about that? Because, you know, the Carter administration was, you know, Jimmy Carter is not known as a flamboyant person. The White House is a very different White House, given the fact that we were coming out of a recession. But it was the same thing with Jackie Kennedy. You were coming off the Eisenhower administration. President Eisenhower wasn't also very flamboyant. But ultimately, when the public got over it, we saw Frank Sinatra at the White House. We saw John Travolta. We saw Princess Diana.
Absolutely. Let me tell you, Santa Barbara's a lot different from Plains, Georgia, just for the record. And going to the fishing hole and being attacked by crazy rabbits, which happened during the Carter administration, which was definitely something for my book in 100 years. I think, and Bill touched on this, you know, it was the times that made it feel a little bit tougher. You know, she was not an apologist. You know, there were New Year's Eve parties in Palm Springs, and we were on the highway taking pictures of the people going in, and I used to think to myself and say to the cameraman, you know what, if I took all the jewelry, I could probably pay off a fair amount of some city's debt. But she felt it was part of her. This is who she was. She felt also that she gave designers a frontline view. Oscar de la Renta, you know, these are people she felt she was investing in. But it didn't feel great at the time. You know, it just was about the time. And I think the Camelot, the times were different. And here was Nancy Reagan coming in during the recession. So it was a little tougher. But she was not an apologist.
All right, our coverage of Nancy Reagan's funeral is going to continue after a quick break. But first, I want to share with you a very beautiful moment between Nancy and President Reagan.
The song, Our Love Is Here to Stay, was a symbol of their marriage.
And the telephone, and the movies that we know may just be passing fancies, and in time may go. Oh, my dear, our love is here to stay. Together we're going a long, long way. In time the Rockies may crumble, Gibraltar may tumble.
All right, we're going to take a quick break. Stay with us. This is CBSN. Welcome back to CBSN special coverage of the funeral service for former First Lady Nancy Reagan. There we see former Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger. We saw former Speaker of the House Newt Gingrich in attendance. Joe Scarborough, Larry King, a couple of other personalities. There are a lot of people expected to attend this. We are covering it with our guests here, Susan Zirinsky, and in Washington, Bill Plante. Susan, I want to ask you, I was talking to somebody just recently about this and about the Reagan presidency, and I said, I wonder when did we as Americans start to think that we wanted to have a beer with our president? I said, I can't imagine during the 1930s, during the migrant crisis, the Great Depression, that people looked at FDR and said, you know, he's the kind of guy that I want to hang out with. They thought of him as somebody who was a leader, somebody who was smarter than perhaps a lot of other people, and that's why he's the president of the United States. Somebody said to me, it's Ronald Reagan. He was that very folksy, very charming, very homespun goodness that people related to, and every president since Reagan has tried to be like that.
You know, it's interesting because here was Jimmy Carter from Plains, Georgia, you know, in a very kind of rural area where the White House press corps came, but he was kind of standoffish. He was aloof.
Right.
And Ronald Reagan really, like, loved people. You know, we would go and record radio and they wouldn't want me to talk to him, and he'd be really kind of saying, well, where did everybody go to dinner last night? There's some phenomenal pictures of Reagan up at the ranch where he really felt good. He chopped wood. Here was a man that felt much more comfortable in a cap and a white t-shirt.
And you'd have pictures. You took pictures during, as we see Mr. T, it looks like, I think, coming into the funeral service, but you took some pictures of the times that you were.
Absolutely, and Bill will talk to this. I mean, you know, when he was at the ranch, he felt just whole. And I think that's what people related to. I mean, we had Fancy Nancy, and we had her, you know, her love of her life, who was quite different. He loved to ride a Jeep. He loved to ride a horse. People thought, wow, like, I go with a beer. Bill, don't you agree?
Well, yeah, he was easy to talk to, but we always talked about exactly the same things, and those were his years in Hollywood. She was actually someone we could talk to about many different things when we had one of our infrequent opportunities to speak. We talked to the president much more often. He never gave us much in the way of news.
But did he miss Hollywood? Not that he didn't enjoy being president of the United States, but I know that he was very close to the old school guys like Burt Lancaster and Sinatra, and that was part of his interests.
Absolutely, he was. He was the he remembered all of those years and all of those people, and he told stories about them incessantly. This happened on the set of this movie, and I was out once with this guy, and it went on and on. These were his memories, and that was really a big part of who Ronald Reagan was.
I mean, there were some times, and we used to check, there were a couple of times where people thought that in a real event, he invoked a story from the movies, and what was the real event? Was he just by accident remembering part of the movie, or was this a real event that had happened? There was a very funny time, though, you know, when Gorbachev and Raisa came for their first visit to the White House, and Raisa and Nancy Reagan were touring the White House, and here were these two kind of regal ladies, and there's an amazingly funny picture of Reagan and Gorbachev, because they were late coming back, and they're both pointing to their watches. and I think Nancy really enjoyed that part of the job, and, you know, you could really see it. Very different from Michelle Obama, mm-hmm. but there was a connectivity that she had, and you kind of enjoyed it when she had her own moments like that with Raisa.
All right, we want to let our viewers know, of course, we're continuing to keep our eye on this picture. We saw a moment ago Tom Brokaw, who will be speaking at today's service. But right now, let's go to our Ben Tracy, who was there at the site of today's funeral. Ben, I understand you've seen some more notable arrivals.
Yeah, some of the biggest names that will be at this funeral today are now arriving. Just a few moments ago, we had a motorcade go by with a bunch of Secret Service agents, and we're told that is indeed Hillary Clinton, who has arrived here in her capacity as a former First Lady. Earlier this week, I did ask the Reagan Library, would the Republican presidential candidates be invited? And very diplomatically, the head of the library told me, well, if they asked to come, we would let them come. But Hillary Clinton is obviously in a different category, being a former first lady. So some of the biggest names are in there. There is a row of empty seats still in the front, and that's for the governor of California, Jerry Brown. That's for the first lady of the United States, Michelle Obama, as well as former President George W. Bush, his wife, Laura Bush. Mrs. Carter is going to be here. So this will be quite a room when you think about it. And so far, the rain is holding off. They were very concerned that at this point it would be raining. They have constructed, as you can see from the video, this massive tent on this patio outside the Reagan Library. So far, fingers crossed, the weather is cooperating. But we do expect to see the First Lady arrive shortly. She will likely be one of the last guests to arrive. And then the program is scheduled to begin sharply at the top of the hour.
All right, Ben, Tracy, we're going to keep checking in with you throughout this funeral service there as we see Diane Sawyer, the well-known anchor for ABC News, also in attendance, but was also part of the White House at some point, working for Richard Nixon. So before she became
before
she came to CBS, let's put it that way. And so let's pivot now and talk more about the assassination attempt on President Reagan. We have Del Quinton Wilbur. He's joining us now to talk a bit more about that horrific moment, a moment that a lot of Americans did not expect to see coming really only just 20 years or so after the assassination of President John F. Kennedy. Mr. Wilbur, are you with us?
Yeah, I am.
What can you tell us about those moments, especially in the days following the assassination attempt, when we as the public didn't really know what was happening in that hospital room with the President of the United States?
Well, you know, this was one of the most dramatic days and dramatic weeks in U.S. presidential history, and it affected the future of the very country. This day reshaped and recalibrated Reagan's presidency, and also helped shape the legacy. I know we're focusing now on Nancy Reagan's funeral, and I have a piece in today's Los Angeles Times about how this day fundamentally reshaped her persona, her own psychology. After this day, she became a worrier. She was all worried about the president all the time. When he left the White House, she was always concerned, could this happen again? That made her more kind of more aggressive in her helping run the government, helping ask questions of her, where the travel arrangements were for her husband, things like that. It shaped her. And, you know, I interviewed Tim McCarthy, an agent who was on the president's detail that day on March 30th, 1981, and took a bullet for the president, in fact. And he was out there just a few years ago, and he met with her in Bel Air, her home in Bel Air. And she just looked at him and said, you know, every time I think about that day, I feel a chill down my spine. You know, it's an ever-present thing. In 2011, you know, I wrote a book about the Reagan assassination attempt. And in 2011, I gave a speech with Jerry Parr, the agent who saved Reagan's life not once but twice on March 30th, 81. And we're just sitting there talking, and Nancy Reagan, starts to say something to Jerry Parr, and, her eyes started glistening. Like, she saw something in this old guy's face. You know, he was 80 at the time. He passed away this last year. And she just saw something in his face. And I don't know what it was, but her eyes glistened and her hands trembled, and she put her hand on his shoulder and said, Jerry, thank you for giving me my life back. And it just, this day and those weeks that you're talking about, behind the scenes stuff, that shaped everything going forward in this presidency. It built a bond with the American people that hadn't been there before. People wondered, you know, about Reagan. Hey, he's just an actor. You know, you've talked a lot about Hollywood so far, and he's an actor who repeats his lines. But on that day, he was quite heroic. And, you know, he cracked a joke when his wife comes into the emergency room to see him, and he has this chest tube in his side. He's clearly in a lot of pain, but his first thought is, how do I calm my frightened wife down? And he says to her, honey, I forgot to duck. You know, stealing a line from Jack Dempsey, right? And that gets out. And then before surgery, he takes off his oxygen mask and dramatically says, you know, he dramatically says to the doctor, I hope you're all Republicans. And those lines got out. And the American public knew at that instant that the one time, was he reading from a script all the time or whatever? Well, the script got thrown out at 2:27 p.m. when John Hinckley opened fire and shot the president and three other people, right? The script is out. It's done. There's no script for this. And they realized, you know, you can't fake it when you've been shot. And that's who he really was. And I think it built a bond with the American people that hadn't been there before.
Del, as you were speaking, it was actually apropos because we saw a shot of former Secretary of State George Shultz in the audience in attendance there. And what's interesting is maybe a lot of the American people don't know this, that the preceding Secretary of State, Alexander Haig, in the days after President Reagan was shot, there was a bit, as you said, very few people were prepared for it. There was some discussion as to what the chain of command would be in the United States government, and Alexander Haig seemingly grabbing the bull by the horns, not constitutionally empowered, sort of said that he was in charge.
Oh, directly.
And Z, that probably led ultimately to George Shultz ultimately taking over as Secretary of State.
Well, I mean, he literally said, "I'm in charge, Al Haig." And I dare say that Nancy, who was really concerned about Reagan's health at that point, but that those repercussions of Al Haig standing in the press room saying, "I'm in charge," that you can get a visceral reaction from anybody from that day.
Del, what do you remember about that moment? Because it was a surreal moment for a lot of people.
Well, you know, that's a fascinating chapter, actually, in the book. The National Security Advisor at the time, Dick Allen, actually brought a tape recorder into that room and hit record, and it ran for 4 hours, and he gave me those tapes. So you know all the behind-the-scenes jockeying that actually happened on this dramatic day. And Al Haig was, like, fighting for control. And actually, his famous words are, a lot of people get this confused. They say, "I'm in charge here." No, he said, "Actually, I am in control here." You know, and the vice president at the time was not around. The vice president was politicking in Texas. He was on a plane flying, racing back to Washington. And, there, you know, we think today that, yo, you can call, you know, the president can pick up the phone in his limousine and call, like, a nuclear submarine, right? Well, back then, they didn't have secure voice communications to Air Force Two. And so there was very little communication back and forth between the vice president and the people in the White House. So Al Haig tried to take control of the situation. And everything started falling apart when Larry Speaks had returned from the hospital. And remember, like, we all think back to, oh, Reagan got wounded, he was fine, he was winged, you know, nothing really serious happened. And in reality, Reagan came within an inch and a split second and one good decision from dying. The bullet was lodged just an inch from his heart. He lost more than half his blood. When he got to the trauma bay, he collapsed. They couldn't detect his blood pressure, it was so low. If Jerry Parr, the agent, hadn't hustled him into the car and made a decision to go to the hospital and not the White House, Ronald Reagan would have died. And the public, not even the people at the White House, really understood this. It was so fast moving. They rush him into surgery. You know, they have these protocols in the situation, but who's going to run what? The Treasury Secretary is there. The Attorney General's there, the head of the CIA is there, they're all there. And Al Haig is trying to be the point person to keep control of everything. And he wants, ironically, for everyone to run everything by everyone at this table in the situation room before any public pronouncements or anything. Well, Larry Speaks goes on the TV and he's answering questions in a very poor manner. He's like, "Well, we don't know." And then one of the reporters asked a question, I believe it was Leslie Stahl. "Well, wait a minute, we just talked to the president's brother, says he's in surgery." And he's like, "I don't know." And so it's crazy. And so, like, people in the room are like, "Oh God, you know, we don't look like we're hiding something. We look like we don't even know." That's even worse than trying to hide something. And so Al Haig storms up to the podium, right? And he goes up the chair, he grabs Dick Allen, and you can hear it on the tape. He's like, "Oh, Speaks is making a mess of it. We're going upstairs." And Allen brings his tape recorder with him. They climb up the stairs, and then he gets the podium, and you can hear his West Point ring clack against the podium. He's sitting there. But Al Haig had like quadruple bypass surgery only a year earlier, like a serious heart operation, and he wasn't quite the same guy. And so that charge up the stairs kind of, like, I believe, you know, took something out of him, and he just was, like, not present. And then Dick Allen is standing next to him. Now, put yourself in this situation, right? The president's been shot. He's in surgery, right? He nearly died. They say he's probably going to make it now, but you don't want to send any bad messages to the rest of the world, right? You know, the vice president's on a plane coming back that you can't talk to him, whose voice communications are so unsecured that I tracked down two University of Alabama graduate students who were listening into them, okay? This is like, this is a mess. And so, you know, Al Haig gets on at the podium and, you know, his legs start buckling and Dick Allen thinks he's gonna collapse, you know, and just put yourself in Dick Allen's mind. Like, oh my gosh, the Secretary of State's gonna collapse. What do? Drag him off the stage? Or, you know, do I continue the briefing if he falls over? And he didn't. He made his mistake saying, "I'm in control," botched presidential succession. And you know how and we all know now what happened from there. He had already had a troubled relationship with the Reagans, and he was gone within a year.
It is such a fascinating story, Del. Really, really fascinating, and a real look inside what was happening in the days after the assassination attempt on President Ronald Reagan. Go ahead, Elaine.
Dale Quinton Wilbur, just thank you so much for that insight. Really fascinating to hear about those moments, which at the time, of course, the public had no idea what was happening. Thank you so much for that.
Bill, you were covering the White House at the time. I don't know if you or Z, if you were in the press briefing room. I think Dale said Leslie was there. Mm-hmm. But that moment that Al Haig came out in the hours after the assassination attempt.
Not only was I in the press briefing room, I'm the one who asked Haig the question.
Now, we'll see. That's why we are, Elaine and I are so privileged and honored to work at CBS News.
That's exactly right.
And he was a mess. He was trembling, quivering, just as you heard from Del Quentin Wilbur. He was a total wreck. And I've had a chance to listen to the tape recordings that Del was referring to, made by Richard Allen, the National Security Advisor. It was the beginning of Haig's long descent out. Because when Mrs. Reagan heard about it, I was reliably informed later, she was furious. The idea that the White House didn't really get what was going on was what was communicated to the public, and that was very dangerous. I mean, at one point they announced that the press secretary, James Brady, had died. There were all kinds of miscommunications that day, and it eventually got straightened out, but it is not, as you were saying earlier, how you want the optics to be.
Bill, you know, I was struck by something that Dell said. You know, years later, he talked about that meeting between the Secret Service agent Jack Parr and Nancy Reagan, in which she thanked him for essentially making the decision to take him straight to the hospital rather than going to the White House, as was the protocol or one of the options available. He decided to take him straight to the hospital, a decision that she thanked him for. But, you know, it's fascinating because one could look at that situation and also see how she could have held a grudge. She could have been upset that, in fact, a shooter got within such close proximity and was able to, you know, to get that assassination attempt, even as he was surrounded by Secret Service agents. But she didn't do that. She chose not to go that route. Instead, she chose to go down this very gracious route of understanding that those men surrounding her husband did what they felt they needed to do at the time to save his life. That's what she chose to focus on.
That's true. She was furious at the time that there was not enough protection to keep the president from getting shot. But she always thanked Agent Parr for what he did, because as Del Wilbur told us earlier, he saved the president's life not once but twice by realizing that he had a lung injury because he was aspirating blood, and by getting him to the hospital instead of to the White House. So I think she was most grateful for that.
Z, you wanted to add?
Well, you know, it was for a while, really, and really for most of the rest of the Reagan presidency, it was her concern about how close that press line was and that people could get in it. I just want to say something before I go into a different direction. She really did value these people that were around the president. She didn't just treat them as government workers, automatons. She really and you might not have thought that. More than just the protection of the president, she formed real relationships with some of the Secret Service. I'm still friendly with a couple of the agents who were on the Reagan detail, my co-runners, I might add. And they talked about having this relationship with Nancy, like she would send them cards, they would send Christmas cards. So there was that. But I think one of the aftermaths of the Reagan assassination, and Bill would definitely played a part in this, is that we found ourselves in the press corps moved back. Like, you just didn't get that close, which made it really difficult to ask a question. Even the press corps by Air Force One, my colleague Bill Plante once resorted to a megaphone to ask President Reagan a question, which I heard from the First Lady's office, and somebody nameless called me up and said, really? Really? But the president did turn around when Plante used the megaphone, but that was really Nancy's impact. Press was too close. Yeah. Keep them back. And sometimes I thought we were being used as human shields, where we were put in place of a rope line. It was the press and then the public behind us. So
yeah, that's interesting.
The impact was felt.
Yeah. In her later years, she began to champion the fight to bring awareness to Alzheimer's disease. That is something that surprised a lot of people because it a lot of the struggle for people with Alzheimer's disease and the doctors who struggle to try and cure people is the stem cell research that is done. And she became a very vocal, somebody who was very vocal about using those stem cells to help research the causes of Alzheimer's disease.
Look, Reagan and Nancy Reagan were like the king and queen of the Republican Party, but she took a very strong stand, not one that that party endorses, of stem cell transplant. And Bill knows that very well because this really was she was a champion for that, really contributed and brought people in. Bill, I know you want to speak to this because her impact was felt. Mm.
She spent 10 years as his primary caregiver, and she didn't let anybody else in except, I think, the children. They didn't see him. She was very conscious of his image. And she came to believe that stem cell research offered the best possibility for an Alzheimer's cure. So beginning in 2004, she went public. And this, of course, went against the general wishes of the party and the Bush administration for using stem cells, fetal stem cells. So she was very open to this, and she raised millions of dollars for Alzheimer's research in the later years.
Bill, I just want to ask about, given especially the political climate today, can you remind us what it was like with Nancy and Ronald Reagan and the social outreach that they did? I think Peggy Noonan said they held something like 56 state dinners, and these were not events to which only Republicans were invited, but Democrats were invited as well.
And press corps.
Tell us about that, Bill.
Well, they did have a state dinner practically every month while they were in the White House, and they were gala affairs. They made no apology for it. They felt that it was, again, part of projecting the image of the United States as a world power and as a gracious host to reach out to all these various nations. The state dinner has fallen out of favor in subsequent administrations. There weren't that many in the Clinton years. There were far fewer in the George W. Bush years, and there have only been, I think, 6 in the Obama years. So it was a different time and a different notion of why we would do something like put on an expensive state dinner.
Bill, I just want to interrupt you as we see First Lady Michelle Obama coming into the service, as well as Secretary Hillary Clinton, who is there in her capacity also as a former First Lady, and also Laura Bush in attendance, again, a former First Lady herself entering the room.
And there you see former President Bush
as well. So here's a question for both of you. Did she have any friends? I mean, I struggle to think about, when I think about, Hillary Clinton, we think Huma Abedin or some of her close confidants that she keeps around her. But I struggle to think, who was Nancy Reagan's friend, if not just Ronnie?
She did have some very close women friends. Betsy Bloomingdale was a very close friend of hers. And, as you're getting close to the ceremony, I think, as people were a little leery of her and her wealth and the fancy Nancy aspect to mm-hmm. herself, I think as the years have gone by, her legacy has grown and the impact that she had and the love story she had and just everything really played into her legacy. And I think, today is a day that we remember this woman who went against the Republican Party for stem cell and just really embraced people in a different way, but really embraced people.
That is a moving sentiment, Z, as we begin now to watch the funeral service. It is just about to begin.